Hello, my name is Dr. Nimzingladep. I'm a hepatologist with a special research interest in liver cancer. I had obtained my first medical degree in Nigeria and then moved over to London at Imperial College, London, where I obtained a PhD in liver cancer and hepatology. I just want to give a bit of brief talk on hepatitis. It's a very commonly described condition. A lot of it is shrouded in secrecy, and so many people are ignorant about this. And sometimes the fear of what it is actually has led people to shy away from accessing orthodox care. And indeed, a lot of Chinese whispers has led people to believe that there is some cure, and which indeed has led them to accessing help from quacks and those who do not know better. And some of these therapies have actually led to the early demise of so many people. And because of that, I felt there's a need to actually educate the populace, who will then be able to safeguard their livers in order to enjoy a good healthy lifestyle. As a beginning, I'll talk about what it is. Now, hepatitis means inflammation of the liver. Now, inflammation is a broad terminology which describes when a tissue is injured or an organ is injured, and the reaction or response to that injury leads to the changes which eventual ultimate outcome is inability of that organ to function as it normally would. And so hepatic refers to the liver. Itis means inflammation. A lot of things can cause an inflammation of the liver, ranging from drugs to viruses to even bacteria, and a lot of other things that, like toxins as well. For the purpose of this discussion, my interest will be on the viral causes of hepatitis. There are two forms, that is the acute one and then the chronic hepatitis. Acute means an inflammation of the liver lasting just less than 6 months, whereas chronic is actually referring to a duration when an inflammation of the liver lasts beyond 6 months. What that means is that there are causes that can actually last long. Most of the chronic causes of liver disease or liver inflammation would actually have passed through the phase of acute infection, and acute inflammation rather. Eventually, when it lasts long, it means that the damage goes on unperturbed, thereby creating ongoing damage with significant tendency to chronic complications such as cirrhosis of the liver, that is when the liver cells become completely overtaken by fibrotic cells, meaning that the cells no longer produce the functions for which they are supposed to be producing functions, and or the development of cancer. At that point, it's quite difficult to treat. However, before the formation of cancers, a lot of things can be done. Looking at viral hepatitis, the commonly encountered ones are hepatitis B and hepatitis C, which are known to be associated with chronicity. In other words, their inflammation are likely to last beyond 6 months. Now, for the purpose of this discussion, I'll again talk about hepatitis B. Hepatitis C is also common, but it's not as common as hepatitis B. For example, globally, we know that about 350 or about 400 million people worldwide have hepatitis B chronically in their bloodstream and causing damage to their liver, or at all at different stages. Whereas hepatitis C affects about 170 million people globally. Indeed, the interest is on hepatitis B because a lot of sufferers of hepatitis B are in developing countries where resources for managing this is limited. And my interest is actually to target this group of people to provide some kind of education that would be helpful. Globally, there has been an outcry for the World Health Organization to recognize this condition as a public health menace in order to ensure that it forms part of the global development goals, in order for resources to be pumped into helping those who are in need of treatment or management of this condition. Before that happens, indeed, each government and each people are supposed to do what they can do. Now, what the chronic hepatitis B has diverse outlooks. How do we define this? There's a single blood test that can be done, known as surface antigen of hepatitis B. When that is present in the blood, it does not define the fact that you have got chronic hepatitis. All it says is that you've got some evidence of the hepatitis virus B in your blood. What makes it chronic would be if that test is repeated 6 months afterward and it remains positive. Then we say you've got chronic hepatitis B. Most of people who develop chronicity are those whose immune system, that is the system of the body that fights infection or strange beings or germs in the blood, are not well developed. In which case, when the virus enters your system at that stage, the immature immune system would not be able to get rid of the virus, which means that the virus would remain in the system and cause ongoing chronic damage, and thereby remaining longer, and so it becomes chronic. In a situation where the infection happens in somebody whose immune system is very strong, then there's a high chance that they're able to cure, remove this virus from their system by their robust immune system. That means that the chance of chronicity is less. The reason why hepatitis B is very common in developing countries is that the way it is transmitted in the developing countries is slightly different from the way it's transmitted in the developed world. Whereas most transmission occurs from mother to child, as well as within toddlers, small children playing with each other in the developing countries, most infections in the developed world occur in adults, which means that they are more likely to clear the virus from their system more than those who acquire the infection at a young age when the immune system is not robust enough to clear it from the system. So that's one reason why the virus actually lasts longer and then cause chronic problems more in the developing country people. Now, when the virus has been found and you've got hepatitis B surface antigen in your blood, It is not a death sentence. What that means is that there are about four scenarios. One, you may just be a chronic carrier. In other words, you've got the virus in low circulation within your body. It is not causing any damage, and it is just present. The second scenario is that you've got the hepatitis B virus in your blood. It is causing damage and requires some kind of action regarding curing it. The third one is that the virus has actually advanced in the damage and it has converted the liver into a mass of fibrotic tissue, thereby impairing the function of the liver. And that's when several of these complications, including a massive retention of water in the abdomen, or vomiting of blood, or swelling of legs, or drowsiness and sleepiness, or even coma can occur. The fourth scenario is that the person who has the virus may actually have a cancer of the liver. Now that is the reality and must not always happen. Now, each of these stages and each of the four segments I've described manifest in different ways. If you're just a chronic carrier, it is often an incidental finding. In other words, you may have gone to donate blood and then they found you to have hepatitis B. If you're having ongoing damage to your liver, there may or may not be any symptom. Most people would complain of lethargy as well as non-specific joint pains, tiredness. Very rarely would they have jaundice, that is yellowish discoloration of the eyes or the skin. The third scenario, cirrhosis. At this stage, the liver damage has started to occur in an advanced way. At that point, the swelling of the legs or sudden vomiting of blood or passing of blood from the backside, or even feeling very drowsy, sleeping more in the daytime than at nighttime, and or losing memory or behaving in some kind of unusual way. Oh, sometimes this can also present with sudden deterioration in health. Those are the complications of cirrhosis, and there are many more. The fourth scenario is that's cancer. There's a typical presentation in an advanced stage, something we call orange on stick appearance. The person would be completely wasted, particularly in the limbs, with a massive abdominal swelling. There's a typical description of this in an African setting, with a massive painful abdomen and a very hard nodular liver. At that point, not much can be done. Indeed, globally we know that cancer of the liver occurs much more in the developing countries, particularly because resources are unavailable for early detection, and even at-risk people are not easily reached as there is no screening program ongoing. Obviously, we do know that screening is very expensive, and indeed, unless people are aware and are looking forward to checking themselves, it may be very difficult to pick up cases. Where there are resources and a screening program goes on well, there has been evidence to confirm that liver cancer can be picked up at early stages when treatment is effective. And some of the treatments are not too exotic. For example, a simple injection of absolute alcohol into the tumor could actually be done within a developing country setting, and this can actually destroy an early cancer and give the survival a good lifestyle and a good, probably a better quality of life. So I think to some degree, there has got to be some knowledge of what to do. Now that's just going beyond the title of what I intend to share in this video. Most of what I've intended to describe is when you've got a positive surface antigen of hepatitis B, what are the scenarios? And I've discussed four of them. Now, of course, this is not intended to give you treatment, but whatever the class you belong, it makes sense to access healthcare, particularly from qualified persons, people who are trained with special interest in this condition. You will indeed be examined clinically, and more blood tests would be done. And when these have been sorted, then it can define which category you belong. Some of the tests would include doing a scan of your liver, and then doing some viral count of the hepatitis B virus from your blood. In some circumstances, they may require to take a small tissue of your liver to check whether the inflammation is of the nature or significance that require a particular type of treatment. And once they've got the information, then you're discussed with regarding what will be done. That is the scenario that I'm putting across, and at this point, I will not give more than you can chew. But think through this, and we will talk again at another time. Thank you very much for your time. God bless you. I welcome your comments. Please.